We're just a little bit out from the election. We hear a lot about internal polling and other polling, but in the last couple of years, polling has not always been the most accurate thing in terms of Kentucky politics. So where do you feel that you and Governor Bevin are at in terms of the campaign, and what do you expect in the next couple months?
I think we're ahead. I think people can feel that too. So the talk is right now that the momentum has shifted. I think we came out of a primary where the governor put out a few positive ads, but there was quite a bit of money thrown at him with negative ads. And so people were, you know, if they pull right after that, naturally you're gonna get a certain result. I think now that the message has become a binary choice between two candidates, I think it becomes very clear that you have someone who's moving the state forward, someone who wants to take the state backward to where things were at before. I think it's clear that you have a pro-life candidate, one who's obviously a pro-abortion candidate, someone who's done tremendous economic advancements for the state, and one that I think finds offense with the Chamber of Commerce and a lot of the business community. Somebody who supports President Trump and his values for the state, for the country, and one who says he wants to work against him. So it becomes a very simple choice for a lot of voters. And I think as the message has gotten out, people have started to say, okay, you know, we support Governor Bevin and his position on that. But I think, you know, polling typically is very good to show trends and where momentum is. And I think if you look at all the polling, it is clearly trended in our direction. There's a lot of entities that are polling. And I think if you look, those that are independent have placed us ahead in the campaign right now. And I think a lot of them also take a look at registered voters rather than likely voters. And when you look at registered voters, we know that the rolls in this state are not clean. There's a lot of people that have either moved out of state years ago or who are dead who are still on our voting rolls, and it makes it look like one party has more registrants than they really do. And if you use that model, it throws off your actual results. And I think that's part of the reason why you've seen so many of the previous models not work. So I think we feel like we're ahead. I think people feel that. The talk out there is that. So we're encouraged.
So speaking of the talk out and on the campaign trail, when you're out talking to voters, what is the main thing you're hearing from them? What are they wanting to see addressed in the next couple of years, or what are their biggest priorities or concerns?
Yeah, I think people are happy with the economic development in the state. Again, we remind them of the amount of investment, $20 billion, 50, you know, a private investment, 54,000 new jobs. We've seen the lowest unemployment rate that we've ever had, highest workforce participation. So from employers, we hear, hey, we have need for more workers. We need more folks here. So we have to grow the population somehow in that regard. I think for a lot of other voters also, I think Kentucky voters are pro-life voters in this state. And when they take a look at someone who's pro-life and one who's pro-abortion, I think it's very clear in that aspect. And a lot of people come forward with that. I think a lot of folks appreciate the work that the governor has done on trying to resolve the pensions. And we've gotten a few things accomplished, but there's so much more to do to really fix the problem. And I think people who realize that this has been ignored, he didn't create this problem, he's trying to fix it, are appreciative of that. And we're hearing a lot of folks that are supportive of that. And also, I think on the national front, things like sanctuary cities, which is something that's come to the forefront, that Kentucky voters do not want sanctuary cities in our state. Again, two distinct choices. One who's already, you know, Governor Bevin's already endorsed a bill that will hopefully be coming forward in January to outlaw sanctuary cities in Kentucky. And then you've got Andy Beshear, who says, no, I support those, and I don't think we need that bill. So there's a lot of those kind of clear contrasts, but I think people like the fact that we're growing as a state. There's a general sense of hope in Kentucky for the first time in a long time, and Kentucky has people that are very proud, and we're proud of our state, we're proud of who we are, we're proud of our culture. When you mix that with hope, it's a powerful combination, and this state is primed for growth under Bevin's leadership.
So you've been in the Senate for a couple years now, and you have a really strong role in the Senate. So what made you choose to go ahead and run with Governor Bevin? And have you guys discussed what that role will look like if you guys are elected? Some have been cabinet secretaries before and lieutenant governor.
Right.
What do you expect your role to look like?
So, the governor asked me. That's the first reason why I chose. Not every day that you have an incumbent governor call you up and ask you to run. So I was honored, really. I was humbled. He caught me off guard. And he told me, you know, he's had nothing but glowing things to say about Jeanine Hampton and says she's been wonderful, a dear friend. But I need someone in a bit of a different role in my second term. I need someone who understands the process and the legislative side of things, someone who can get bills across the finish line, someone who knows how the General Assembly thinks and wants to work. And I think he's seen my work ethic. I know I file a lot of bills, famously so. But he says, I see how you work and get things done. And I think he knows my motivations and why I'm in office. So he asked me to do it. And my wife and I prayed about it. And we thought, you know, God has put this door before us. Either we walk through this and it's a different trajectory in our lives, or we close the door and it never comes back again. And And when I called the governor back, I told him I would give him my best. I'll give the office and the Commonwealth my best in this role. And he talked to me about what I thought the role should be. And so I think he leaves it a bit more open, as he does to a lot of his cabinet members. What do you think you should do? And I've told him I think you need someone who's a good liaison, someone who's effectively going to be a type of an offensive coordinator for a lot of his bills. And he's got people right now that serve in that liaison capacity. But you also have to work on offense and defense sometimes with bills that affect the executive branch and some that you're trying to get done to advance the state. So I'll be part of that team to help him move those things through. And I think also I want to be a bit of a link for him to local government. I look forward to, after the General Assembly gets concluded in April, to travel the state, meet with local officials, meet with local community leaders, find out what their needs are, what they would envision for their regions and for their communities, and how the state can ally with them and provide resources to make them more successful at that too. So I'm looking forward to being that type of a role.
So on some of the points that you made, there have been news reports about the governor and the legislature not getting along, especially in the last 4 years. So do you feel that you can help kind of bridge that gap if you all are elected?
I think we already have an example of that. So the special session we just saw happen was a prime example of how that's already worked. So when the governor and informed me he was going to veto the bill, I immediately got on the phone with a lot of our quasi-governmental agencies. We had meetings with them. We started meeting with some key players in the legislature to put together a bill. And then we gradually worked that bill and started talking to members and talking to individual folks. And there were people who were supportive out of the gate, some who wanted other changes. And we quickly had meetings with those and found out what those needed to be. And then once we had the bill put together that had the votes necessary to pass it, it moved through. And we had meetings with leadership, House and Senate both, with the governor and myself. And I thought those meetings were very constructive. They were good, and people felt very good coming out of those. And then I think you saw the ease with which that bill passed once it came to the special session. That's a testament to House and Senate leadership, to the sponsors of the bill, to people like Brian Sunderland and DJ Johnson, and folks that we all worked with together to get that in the place where it needed to go. So once it passed, I think you'll see that as an example of what's to come. And I think a lot of our House and Senate leaders were very pleased, and I think they get the sense that'll be the approach we'll have going forward. I envision more of that kind of success in the next 4 years.
So speaking of the legislature, if Governor Bevin does win re-election, who's going to run for your Senate?
So we've had it's funny, you get that, and people start back home, some of them are very confident, okay, you're going to win this. And I urge them all, please, let's make sure the seat is vacant before we try to fill it. And don't pick my bones, and let's make sure we win in November. That's the first order of business. I never like to count chickens before they hatch. So it's always important to focus on the task at hand. But we've had several people in all three counties I represent that have come forward that have expressed interest. There's people in Clark County, Montgomery, Fayette. I've heard rumors of others who are interested. It's always an executive committee, the Republican executive committee will make that decision in Clark and Montgomery and Fayette, so they have equal representation. And I've urged everybody who's expressed interest to go talk to those members, make sure that they get to know them. Some are more well-known, and some are newcomers who aren't as well-known. And I said, it's important to build trust, let people know who you are, why you want to run for office, what you envision. And then, it'll be a function of once that special session gets, the special election gets called, then those executive committee members have to meet and decide on that individual. So it'll be up to that group to make that decision. But there are several people. It's not just one. There's quite a few. So it might be a runoff process before they pick somebody. And there's some that have already tried to meet with other members of the General Assembly. But I don't want to say anything because there's a lot of them that are interested, and it'll be a process to figure that out.